Nick, you want to go this time?
No. I already dropped the ball on it last week.
What's up, everybody? Welcome to the Kind of Funny Podcast. I'm one of your hosts, Greg Miller, alongside the producer slash seducer, Nick Scarpino.
Now, you reached out to me and you said, hey, Nick, which questions did you guys cover last week on for the user submitted questions, or the fan submitted questions, rather? And I was actually kind of a little bummed when I remembered what we talked about that you weren't there for that.
Sure.
Because Tim was so shocked that people would even consider going deep when coming to wiping their own chooch hole.
Crevice.
Yeah, the crevasse, that he was just like, I don't understand why people go deep. And then Andy and I were like, what is the state of Tim's two hole right now? What is that, just like a disgusting wasteland of stench? What's going on with it?
Andy, you've been over there for a lot of movies. What do you smell when you're down there?
Cuddled up on those cuddled up on those reclining seats. What do you when he's sitting on your face?
It's a walk by and you're at butt to eye level. The smell factor.
I don't get anything there though. But I am concerned though, Nick. I understand why you have concerns about what's going down deep right in the trenches. You know, I am kind of worried. Because I think you and I have a very similar sort of thought process, right? We want to be extra careful.
Yeah.
So the way I do it, Greg, these guys fucking flip their shit. You know, Kevin was like, what? You do what? And I think you even too, Nick. Maybe not you. I don't know. Maybe
I was a little against your methodology.
I go front to back, right?
Yeah.
And then throw it in the toilet. And then I grab another piece and I go front to back, throw it in the toilet, grab another piece, back to front. You know, like I swap it around just so I make sure I'm covering all these different angles from different, dimensions and stuff. And then I'll get a little deep in there if I need to.
Did anyone bring up a bidet?
I did.
Okay.
That was lightly touched on. But the fact is that was unfortunately disqualified. We weren't talking
Tushy
about
Tushy makes it available for everybody. And if you go to kindoffunny.com, I don't know, we don't have a Tushy sponsorship. But Jen bought a Tushy. I don't know, beginning of the year, right? Right before the pandemic. And of course, I've been to Japan. I'm world traveled. I've known for a long time the power of a bidet. But as Andy said, I thought it was out of my financial reach as a renter in San Francisco. I'm not going to fucking install a nice ass toilet in here. But this Tushy thing you install and it's just there, you got a bidet attached to your thing. And when I leave, I yank that fucker out and I take it with me. You know what I mean?
You do. Yeah. You go to bed with it.
I like handcuff it to myself like the football when I'm doing something else just in case it goes away. But no, we've had that since the pandemic started, which of course, the pandemic meant we all stayed home, which meant I really haven't been shitting other places. And so when we went away for our camping trip last weekend, it was the first time in forever where we were using toilets and just wiping and not using the bidet. And God, is it a gross experience to go back to after having what, 5 months or whatever it's been here? When, I don't even know. Seven?
I know the feeling, Greg. That's me when I'm playing games in 144 hertz at 1440p. I go back to anything else. It's like, what year am I in? What century?
I'll tell you what. Last night I was streaming the Avengers, Andy. All right. And you'll get your intro in a second. Last night I was streaming the Avengers and some kid pops up in his chat, you know, oh, is this in performance mode or 4K mode? And I was like, I don't know. There's a difference. I turned out I was in 4K mode. I'm like, don't you guys want that? And like, no, we can't see the 4K because of stream. I'm like, all right, fine. So I switched over to performance and it is so, the frames are so much faster and it's so much smoother and it just made me sick to my fucking stomach.
What?
I left it on. Don't get me wrong. Like, I left it on, but it was so jarring at first to go from traditional console to like what a performance mode, you know, it's going to run better in terms of frames and shit like that. Like I've left it on and now I'm used to it. But at the beginning it was like, oh man, I'm so unused. It looks weird because it looks so different to me, a console plebe.
Yeah, I understand where you're coming from. It's like when your parents have Motion Plus on or whatever.
Sure. Yeah, yeah.
But
yeah.
Except these aren't simulated frames. These are all just real or whatever. But right. I had that same feeling because, you know, Greg, I bought this really nice fancy Asus monitor at the beginning of the pandemic.
Oh, 1%. Like
around March. And about 3 months into using it is when I discovered that I wasn't using it correctly, like a fucking loser. Mm-hmm. And I tweeted out about it. I was like, don't be like me. Sure. Right now, I bought this 144 hertz monitor to get 144 frames per second, and I didn't go to this one setting, and that kept it in 60 hertz. And to me, I was like, wow, this monitor is crazy. Like, this monitor is, it's so fast. Look at all the, but really it wasn't doing what I bought, for, the reason why I bought it.
Right.
And then Gary Witta also replied to that. I was like, oh my fucking God, I've been using this thing for 2 years and I'd never set that setting. And a bunch of people started replying, oh my God, I never did this correctly. And then your eyes kind of get opened up when you start to see fast motion games the way they're intended to be seen.
Sure. Mm-hmm. Speaking of fast motion games, he's the Hispanic heartthrob, Texas treat, Latino heat, clicking heads and ripping them to shreds, the globe trotting headshot nitro rifle from twitch.tv, Andy Cortez.
I'm full of caffeine, Greg Miller. I'm just dumping my body full of stuff, chemicals. I love it.
What do we got riding shotgun there in the snack seat?
I got two things.
Got some Kashi Goin. All right. Cinnamon harvest.
Clutch.
Oh, and then reduced fat.
Reduced fat. No, come on.
Just reduced fats are crunchier, Greg. They're crunchier and better.
Yeah, no. But they taste too healthy.
No, they don't. They don't, Greg. Believe me. I'm the type that, like, my dream beverage would be for Mountain Dew Zero or Diet Mountain Dew to be good, and they're not. And it's such a heartbreaker because, like, Coke Zero tastes phenomenal.
It's great.
And it's my favorite go-to soda now.
It's always in our house. It's always in our
And it's low calorie. It's always here. We're always buying Coke Zeros. But the idea that, like, Mountain Dew sucks really bums me out. So you could trust me, Greg, when I say that a healthier option tastes better than the original.
I don't believe you. I want you to pour 5 or 6 of them in a manila envelope and mail them to me, and I'll try it myself.
Buy a bag on Amazon.
I'm not going to invest in these, all right? I don't want you giving any more money to the reduced fat people, because then I got a bean counter there over at Sunshine looking through the Cheez-It revenue and going, look, spikes in San Francisco. Send less of the normal Cheez-Its. Send less of the Tabasco Cheez-Its, which are now hot and spicy because they didn't want to pay for the licensing anymore. Dumb. Nick, it sucks.
Dumb. Oh, really?
Hold on.
Wait,
well,
so do they still taste back? Like,
let's dial it back 1 second. I've noticed they're now hot and spicy and they don't say Tabasco on it. So I made up the rumor in my head that they just didn't want to pay licensing to Tabasco. I don't know if there is a Cheez-It newsletter out there or a website following the comings and goings of the Cheez-It Corporation / Sunshine. Let me know and I will subscribe and I'd love to know this.
I'll look for a newsletter.
I mean, if you put, the cracker crumbles, cheese and Tabasco break up. That Google that headline. I'm sure you'll find something. And if you, because that's like what any writer worth their cheese it would say. That's
that
how
is,
you write.
That is. You can't not click on that. You see that your hand just has a mind of its own. I'm clicking on it twice.
Right. Greg, I regret to inform you, I'm on their website. And now, granted, it's a very, very biased website because it's their website. Yeah. And I don't see any news about like this Tabasco breakup of any kind.
In my search bar, I put Cheez-It Tabasco. This first two autofills, Cheez-It Tabasco contract, Cheez-It Tabasco discontinued. I don't know if I've searched those before. Here we go.
Let's see. What happened to Tabasco Cheez-Its? You are correct. Yep. Our partnership with Tabasco has ended. We still have hot sauce in our product and flavor composition has not changed. We hope you continue to enjoy this product. It just sounds like Cheez-It setting itself up
for a
huge lawsuit.
Now, here's what I'd like to say, actually, though. Let's give a round of applause in our home, Snaps, if you're one of the millennials, to Cheez-Its, where this quote comes from is Twitter, where they just answered a random person. Daniel tweeted on November 13th, 2018, at Cheez-It, what's going on here? Not Tabasco official anymore? The people want to know, in all caps. And Cheez-It responds, great, G-R-A-T-E, in quotes. Great question. We are no longer contracting with Tabasco, therefore the image and claim have been removed from the packaging. However, the flavor composition has not changed. We still have hot sauce in our product for spicy.
See, this is where I get the paranoia in me and the anal retentiveness in me wants to go back and find one of the boxes that still has the Tabasco logo and do a side-by-side comparison.
Could you tell?
Bullshit.
I don't think I can tell. That's why I have bought fewer hot and spicy cheeses.
Yeah, they fucked themselves. Cheez-It, I'm sorry, but if you go bankrupt because of this one decision, you deserve it. This is a poor decision at the marketing level. You should have just hemorrhaged money to keep that Tabasco brand. Or get off your duff and reach out to Tapatio, because that would be pretty freaking great.
Hey, that's funny, because you say that. That's one of the first responses was somebody making a joke response to that of, hey, Tapatio, check your DMs. That's
everybody, awesome. Everybody who knows me knows that I love a spicy thing, except for, you know what? Tim didn't know that.
Oh, really? I didn't know that about you. We didn't know Tim's walking around with just the dirtiest butthole. on the planet.
That's true.
When Gia does laundry, she's like, Tip! She watches out in front of Joey and Cool Greg.
We are just perpetuating more bullshit.
Two points of feedback.
You guys did a whole fucking podcast about my camping trip without me being here.
Well, that's true. Why do I imagine that Tim only wears white boxers? So that when it's just, you know what I mean? God. I know he doesn't. I know he wears.
There's no way to escape it. Yeah. Barrett Courtney, by the way, in the ones and twos today. Kevin Coelho. Working hard on a whole bunch of different live streams we did today. So he's taking the afternoon off here. Barrett, I sent you another link that I'd like to show to the audience. There, how do we feel about this right here, Nick Scarpino?
This is a cheesy tweet.
It says, we're pretty sure this is how the Italians do it. And it is a pizza crust with the tomato sauce covered in Cheez-Its. And it says, Cheez-It pizza.
Yeah, I think just from a safety standpoint, this is a terrible idea because you're going to throw that bad boy in the oven and those things are going to immediately start to burn.
Yeah.
Largely because they're already sort of dry, cracker-ish anyway.
Sure.
Put them on after the fact. Yeah.
Yeah, put them on after the fact, I said.
What, then you just got hot sauce on the dough? You got dough and then the sauce consistency won't be the same as if it was covered in cheese.
It's not like the cheese is going to melt or anything.
No, but the cheese is also, in a lot of ways, sort of the foundation. It's like the concrete foundation of the pizza. If you don't have the cheese on it, you don't have the consistency and the gel. It doesn't glue together like you want a piece of pizza to glue together. So I can just imagine you go to cut this. All of those are just going to fall off. They're just going to fall off.
Yeah, 100%. That doesn't seem real. Shout out to our friends at DiGiorno, who are also the first tweet response I see, which is just the emoji with the eyebrow up. What the fuck are you on about?
Gotcha.
Of course, ladies and gentlemen, Tim Gettys not here today washing his underwear, apparently. That's what we're going with now. He worked on a bunch of streams as well, so he's doing over there. If you didn't know, this is the Kind of Funny podcast each and every week. Three best friends gather around this table coming to talk about whatever it is bullshit's going on in their life. They hang out. They talk the shit. You hang out. You listen to the shit, and you like the shit, and we appreciate that because it's our shit, and we appreciate you supporting us and our shit, and we support your shit when we can.
And at the same time, Tim shit.
And it's the same time, Tim shit. Exactly. If you want to support us even more, you can go to patreon.com/kindoffunny, where you can get every episode ad-free. You can get it with the exclusive post-show we do. You could watch live as we record it, just like Adam Werner is, Sapwell. I'm sorry, Dale Sapwell. At first, I thought it was Dale Sapwell. And I thought that would be a dope fucking name, but it's Sapwell. But then I fucked it up and said Spawell.
I'm thinking Spawell.
Oh, my God. It kind of sounds like Jeff Jarrett when he insults people. He's like, get out of here, slap nuts. And you're like, well, I'm slap well, and you slap him really well. You have a built-in gimmick. You know what I mean? Because whenever we introduce, I'm Greg from Kind of Funny. Well, are you kind of funny? I try. I always set the bar low. And if I came up and I was like, I'm Greg Slapwell, I'm like, oh, do you? And I was like, invited in the demon.
Right.
They'd be like, fuck, he does. He slaps well. And I kind of antagonized him there. I brought that on.
I kind of deserve it. Yeah.
Greg, as a weird non sequitur, have you ever had a Snackwell cookie? Because that is good too. That'd be a fun last name.
First off, Nick Scarpino, I know we like to make jokes about how desperately old you are, but you know that I am not that far behind you in age.
Yeah, I know.
Have I ever had a Snackwell? I lived through the Snackwell revolution.
Okay.
Andy, when you were a wee baby, all right, sucking on a nipple somewhere, there were these things, cookies, called Snackwells. And they were such a phenomenon because they were like reduced fat or fat.
Yeah, they were supposed to be quasi healthy.
Was it like the Atkins sort of thing?
No,
they were brand. It was more like, remember when we've talked about it before, when they did the potato chips with the special oil, but it caused anal leakage. But everybody's like, fuck, it's fat free. I can eat all the Doritos I want. It was one of those
small price to pay.
I don't care if I have to wear a diaper. I can finally eat all these Cool Ranch Doritos. But they were the green. You've probably seen them, right, Andy? The boxes, the green Snackwell boxes. Yeah. They had a bunch
of
different.
I know exactly what you're talking about. Devil's Food was like the one that was.
Exactly. That's the one. They had a bunch of different ones. That's the one they took off.
Yeah.
But they their whole campaign was how popular they were, and they had this guy in a lab coat. It was, you remember this, Nick? These commercials, lab coat with a little Snackwell's logo on it. And he'd be stocking the supermarket shelves. And moms and wives would run in and tackle. Because it was one of the things.
Stocking them with merchandise, not like stalking them as a creeper.
Stalking. He was putting the things on the shelf. And they totally ran it as it was this weird thing where it wasn't like, this is the female cookie. But it was one of those kind of things where we didn't have the equality we have now, right? So back then, and it's bad now, but it was worse then. You know what I mean? Right. Thanks, Nick. You know what I mean, though. You know what I mean? Here. Every housewife in every commercial will sell me Pledge or some shit. And it's like, well, that's, furniture polish. Where's the man?
not to lead into this, not to lean in harder to this impending Reddit thread, but my wife did... My wife, in fact, did introduce me to Snackwells. I had no idea what they were, and she was really into them.
Again, this is my thing, is like what they actually marketed it wrong, and they eventually pivoted because it was like, no, moron, everybody wants to eat fucking cookies that aren't as horrible for you as a regular cookie.
Yeah, but they were also just tasty.
They were like delicious. So I think these were a product of the that era where fat was demonized, and everyone's like, these are way less fat than normal cookies. Meanwhile, me and Greg over there on the other side are like, fucking, you're eating 100 grams of sugar per cookie. Who gives a fuck about fat?
My mom would bring them home. And again, like, I was just into these fuckers like nobody's business.
They're soft and mushy.
You know what I mean? Yeah. They were delicious. Yeah, they had a weird texture that everybody loves. I do want to call out this. I do want to call this out right now in the chat. Dale Sapwell says, this is all for my dumbass name. But yeah, Snackwells were the shit, man.
Slapwell. Snackwells. I want some Snackwells now. These devils
fucking movement. Are they still out there?
Can they are. They still sell them, yeah.
Yeah. They kind of reminded me of like the how for a while now, obviously I still eat Skinny Pop popcorn, but for a while Skinny Pop was sort of that popular thing that everybody bought because they knew that it was low fat, low trans or no trans fats, low calorie, all that shit. You know, they were so good that my mom was the one who was buying Snackwells in the house.
Yeah,
I just sent Barrett a commercial, and I if I'm lying, I'm dying. We nailed this thing dead to rights on the entire campaign, and how fucked up it was just glancing at it. Now it's from the good people in Nabisco, by the way. So I didn't want to give a shout out to them, of course.
Yeah, they're usually good as long as it's not the Mr. Bucket people. We're gonna be fine.
Yeah,
all right, play it, Barrett, with some sound up there for kiddies. This guy's a character actor now, too, Nick.
Chocolate sandwich cookies, a delicious way to cut.
Can you need a bear to come in here?
Unbelievable. What if I can't pick enough of these?
Here, we can just voice him. I don't like it, but my wife will.
Oh, the kids can hear it. All right, cool.
Because it's not my man.
Because look, now it's so popular. Get this cookie home. You're going to get it on shelves, right? Three housewives in the back.
What's in the box?
Just and they're just like, give me the fucking cookies, Cookie Man. And then we call them Cookie Man, didn't they? We're talking. I can't hear it, so I can't.
You got a better memory than I do. But these are, if I got into my car, my little tiny car, and found three housewives in the back of it, I think there would be a range of emotions.
Remember, scared but excited.
Right. Andy, I'm bringing it full circle. Remember, he was stalking the shelves. They were stalking him. That was the thing. Yeah. They were hunting him down for these cookies.
So, coming back around.
So, what was the era of this commercial?
Early 90s.
Yeah,
early 2000s.
That looks really early.
One of the ladies asked, "What's in the box?" So I'm wondering if this was the inspiration for that movie.
For that one movie. Yeah.
Like we're talking about Citizen Kane or some classic film no one remembers. That one movie.
Yeah, that one. I'm just saying.
Man, I want some Snackwells now. Yeah, my wife was so into them for a while. She used to make me drive to gas stations. Because in San Francisco, you can find the two-pack at gas stations. So I know in my area which places, like which liquor stores and which gas stations and which like convenience stores or supermarkets have just the two-pack at the checkout. So I can run by and get one of those. Wow. Similar, she knows which ones have the two-pack of the Nutter Butters from her, the four-pack of Nutter Butters because I'm a fucking... Oof, Nutter Butters going out hard.
Here we go, though. I'm on the Snackwells Wikipedia page, right? Introduced in 1992. Its products used to include fat-free cookies of a variety of flavors, including yada, 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 blah, blah, blah. It was previously Nabisco brand. It was then sold to Back to Nature Foods, right? But then it's very bare bones here. I was hoping to see if there's this whole thing going on, if there wasn't. But then there's this thing called the Snackwell effect. You click on, and this is like the Streisand effect. You click on the Snackwell effect. Snackwell effect is a phenomenon that states that dieters will eat more low-calorie cookies, such as Snackwells, than otherwise would for normal cookies. It is also described as a term for the way people go overboard once they are given a free pass or the tendency to overconsume, like in the case of people eating more low-fat food.
I could see
that it's not fattening.
Greg, I could see that. Me with not really the reduced fat cheese, but with the whole grain goldfish, I feel like I go ham on them because I know that, they're a little bit healthier, so I eat them even more. Sure. And it's like, it's the same vibe I get when I was working out a lot. I was like, I'm working out, so I could just eat whatever I want. But like... Yeah. I would overdo the eating and I wasn't seeing any results because it was just, totally canceling out whatever my shitty little 20-minute workout was. Yeah, you know, sure. Like, you get in your head that you're safe, and you're never safe, Nick.
You're never safe. Oh, dude, trust me. So when the pandemic started, when we all started sheltering in place, I was like, I'm going to be vigilant about work, you know, getting out there, exercising as much as I can, not overeating. And then after month two, I think is where my breaking point happened. That's when I started mainlining Coke Zero and just rewarding myself. We'll say every three nights with Taco Bell. Usually Taco Bell, Greg, for context, is like every third week. I'm like, you know what? It's Taco Bell night. I've been good. I've rolled. I've done this. I've done that. We're crushing it. It's kind of funny. I'm going to reward myself with the best food on the planet. But man, I was going down a dark path there for a while. It was to the point where my wife would just look over at me and I'd be looking at her and she'd be like, fine, let's get in the car and go to Taco Bell. But recently...
Oh, what a reward. That's so exciting.
It's so fun. And, you know, don't think, Andy, I don't want to drop off a 10-pack of tacos every time I go.
Oh, man. If you ever just want to drop by like a little 3-pack, dude, I'm totally down.
Let's play this out. Let's play this out right now.
Okay.
That's him knocking.
Oh.
Hello?
No, hold on. No, do the knock again. Okay. Do the knock again.
Hold on. Sorry. Okay, hold on. Let's okay, stop. Let's do this officially, all right?
Okay.
Scene. Andy's house. 8:30, San Francisco.
If you're going to get a ride, it's going to be 5:45 because I'm usually...
I apologize. 5:45. This changes a little bit. It's not even remotely dark yet, but it is very foggy and overcast.
There's
a stiff breeze. Not too much, though. I was over by Andy's house the other day picking up Fiorella stuff right over there. And I noticed that there was a woman walking by in a bikini bottom. And I was like, ma'am, this section of San Francisco is not warm enough or near a beach enough for this to be happening. And it was freezing outside.
She had a long walk.
It's overcast and cold out there. Nick Scarpino parks his car, which is too small to fit three housewives in the back.
Mm-hmm.
He shuts the door. He carries a Taco Bell bag. He approaches a nondescript house. Go.
Open your fucking door. Hello? Free tacos.
That's a new dog, Lulu. That's the new dog barking.
Wait, you got a new dog? That's cool. I want to see it. Can I come in?
No, thank you.
I'm in my back room over here. You got to yell louder.
Who opened the door? Every single Barrett, because every single time I've dropped anything off for Andy, Barrett answers the door. Because
my bedroom's right next to the front door, so I would be opening. Yeah, yeah,
yeah. Right.
But a lot Andy of people are taking quarantine seriously, but none have taken it more serious than Howard Hughes over here, Andy Cortez, who is locked down in that room like he's going to CBS.
drop it in front of my door, and I'll leave it there for 48 hours and let Andy.
Just let it make sure the coronavirus burns off of it. Yeah, let me tell you one thing right now, Andy. If I bring you over a 10-pack of tacos and you tell me to leave it at your door, you're going to hear a sound you've never heard before, and that sound is going to be what a taco sounds like being stuffed underneath your door.
Oh, gross.
Out of its wrapper. I'm just going to start stuffing naked tacos underneath
just
your door.
Just put them through the mail slot. The mail slot.
But I'm going to be the dickhead that unwraps them first. And so they just
Are they hard shell or soft shell that you're shoving into the door?
I usually go all hard shell. I'm not a big fan of the soft shell tacos, truthfully.
We talked about this in the last show, Greg. By the way, great show.
I saw the beginning because I wanted to watch Nick fuck up, but then I just turned it off right away.
That makes sense. I love soft shell tacos from anywhere else that's not Taco Bell. But if I'm going Taco Bell, it has to be hard shell. Because it's like, it's too fake to try to get an authentic experience, you know? So it's like, just go all fake.
Yeah.
Just go for full fake. You know?
If you go, I mean, once you're dusting something in Doritos dust, all bets are off at that point. There's no rules in this lawless land. We can just do whatever we want.
Once you're getting blasted by the Baja, it's like,
oh, yeah.
Oh, man, I'm just thinking about Taco Bell burps now.
Greg.
Yeah.
End scene. While we have you, how was your camping trip? Was it fun?
It was great, yeah. I had a great time. Real fun. Good hikes out there. It was cool to go camping and start fires.
We watched a movie called Howl's Moving Castle.
I've seen it before.
Have you? Okay.
Went inside a ragtag cinema in Columbia, Missouri.
Oh, that's fun. I can't wait to hear more about that. Well, there's a scene in it where Billy Crystal's character, Calcifer, who is the fire demon, cooks breakfast for everyone with giant strips of bacon and eggs. It made me think of that picture that you took. You put those big old fat strips of bacon on the grill and you were just staring at it like it owed you money.
Yeah, totally. Yeah, that was a good morning. That was a good morning. Cooking over the campfire. I got that little cast iron skillet there. Jen and I whipping up meals. True story, the night before, almost passed out into the fire.
Oh, fun.
Never, drunk? I've never come that close. You know, it's one of those, we talked about it in the moment. and there were
Wait, hold on. I just love Nick asking an honest question. Were you drunk? And Greg's like obvious, like kind of
like he's running around Senate.
And goes, well, you know,
I'm gonna go all in because what the problem was is that there's multiple layers to what was happening. Because I almost passed out in front of this fire. Immediately, you're like, why? Yeah. Right? And so to walk you through what happened is, we're making this fire. I'm attending to it. I'm moving things around because the bag of wood they give you, because it's very specific how to not start a forest fire. So you have to get these good wood bags and they burn a certain way. It wasn't burning the right way. So I was moving stuff around there like the country kid I am, right? And I'm setting up. I'm making the pyramid. I'm getting it all going. I reinvigorate the fire. But I'm doing it over. I haven't done anything with a fire in so long. I'm standing over, like face over the fire while I work on it, right? And so right there's a problem as the fire's eating all the oxygen and just kicking up, carbon monoxide, yeah, right? Definitely. So that's a terrible idea. On top of that, it was way better out there, way better than the city, but there's still an air quality issue with all the forest fires we're having. On top of that, remember that my lungs are chemo lungs and don't process particulates at all anymore. So like that time when I smoked that cigarette with that guy, so Sean Finnegan didn't get his ass beat, but then I thought I got drugged for a while, and it was just I can't smoke cigarettes.
Turns out it was severe oxygen depravity.
That was there. And then on top of that, I was fucking wasted because we hadn't had any food and we drank, I think we're already on a second bottle of wine because we're on vacation. But it was that thing where I was tending to it like in a squat and I stood up. And as soon as I stood up, Nick, I shit you not, like it just went down and it was like, I was like, I'm about to fall. I wasn't thinking in a complete sentence. It was like fall coming. And it was like, Jen started laughing because she saw I was acting weird and she didn't know what was up. She thought I was doing a bit. And then I like literally Frankenstein stumbled without like moving my legs away from the, because it was like, I'm going to fall, get away from fire. Stumbled away from it and then collapsed into the chair. And as soon as I sat down and got a few deep breaths in, Jen's like, what the fuck's going on? I'm like, I almost passed out. Like that was like on the rope, scary, like I was about to go down or whatever.
Dude, I've had that experience many times, largely because of people strangling me. It's a it's a very scary and weirdly off-putting experience to just see the world sort of slow, like just go dark all of a sudden.
Fade a bit, And Jen was like, and I told her the thing, she's like, your lizard brain, your reptile brain kicks in of like, survive, get away, safety, you know what I mean?
I told the story of when they took too much blood out of me, right?
Yeah, but you can tell again.
I told that a long time. So I went to get my blood drawn, and I misread the doctor's instructions. It was the first time I was going in for like a physical in a long time. I don't know why I didn't think that I did it this way, but it said like, don't eat any food for like 12 or 24 hours or whatever the hell they wanted me to do. I took that as don't have any water. So I was severely dehydrated, and the fucking bonehead nurses at this place that was drawing my blood were like, she literally looked at my arm and was like, you look really dehydrated. When's the last time you had water? And I was like, I thought I wasn't supposed to have any water for like 12 hours. She goes, oh, that's not a good thing. Here. And she gave me a little tiny Dixie cup of water. And she's like, you'll be fine. Meanwhile, cut to 5 minutes later, they start drawing blood, vial after vial after vial. And I'm like, I don't feel so. And I just threw up the water all over my crotch and passed out. And it was the most disorienting experience of my life. Because I've never just passed out and then come out of it and been like, it just feels strange. It feels like you get knocked out and you're just like, I just lost. What? How long? How long are you out? How, could have been 5 minutes. Could have been an hour.
How conscious are you? Like, do you have the thoughts going in your brain of, oh, this is bad. Here it goes. Here it goes. Here it goes. Or is it just?
I felt my hands felt numb, like they went cold. Not numb, but like cold. Your whole body gets a chill. You go cold, and then all of a sudden your eyesight just goes whoop, and then you just wake up and you're like, why am I wet? And why am I hunched over? It was very terrifying. And then they were like, well, we got like 10 more people in the waiting room, so you can be in here for 5 minutes, but then you have to go. And they let me leave.
That's fucked up.
It was bad. I was like, I guess I'll get my car, drive home. But hindsight being 2020, I should have just let the car sit there and order an Uber. I had my wife take care of me because it was terrifying.
I was always very worried about going under when I got my wisdom teeth taken out when I was in middle school.
That's fun, though. That's different.
But like at the time, I just didn't know what it would feel like, right?
Oh, it feels good.
Like as a kid, if you would have asked me and... I mean, no, it didn't feel good because it was gas. It wasn't an IV. It wasn't morphine. It wasn't like when I had my kidney stones and they gave me morphine and it felt incredible. It was just like a gas mask. Okay, and I just sat there and they're like, all right, just keep talking to us. Right. Yeah. They were like, and before you know it, I don't even remember the end of the story of what they were saying and I was out. And then I just kind of came to and was just like, and they helped me get into the car or whatever. But the the morphine
on free and pushed out.
I was a 12-year-old kid.
See you later. Good luck.
Here are your keys. I'm like, I don't drive. This isn't my car. But the morphine is the one that felt incredible. That's the one that was like, wow. I get it.
Whatever I got from my wisdom teeth being taken out. I've only been put under a handful of times. And the wisdom teeth one was the one I remember thinking like, oh, because I was scared. And they're like, I'm like, what's it going to feel like? They're like, you're going to be fine. And they did. They injected it into me, whatever the fuck it was. And I was just like, ooh. And the doctor, when I woke up, they like said they were laughing when they first started. I was like, why? They were like, well, we asked you to count back from 100. And I went 199. This shit is really good. And then I passed out. And that was it. Yeah, that was fun. You can understand why people get horribly addicted to that shit.
Oh, like, totally.
Yeah.
Coming back from my wisdom teeth, I remember, doing the countdown and then waking up, but I woke up mid conversation. Like, I'd already been talking for like 10 minutes or whatever. And like, I was mid sentence saying something when you come to, you're like, wait, I'm back. Oh, fuck. What have I done? Or what have I said?
I am so glad that like nobody thought to record me because I like,
sure.
Like, of course, my paranoid mind, whenever I see these funny videos, I'm like, God, I hope that never happens to me. The guy with the nurse and the mom in the room. And the guy's telling the nurse, like, hey, you want to fuck or something? And then, like, they're kind of laughing it up, but it's awkward. It's like, God, I hope I'm not, like, weird
You get a pass, though. You get a free pass.
Yeah, that's one of those things where if I saw that, I'd be like, so, okay, obviously some inappropriate comments are coming out of your drug-addled mouth right now. But I would actually question more the appropriateness of filming someone in that vulnerable state. I would have a bone to pick with that person when I came to in my mouth.
It's always a common friend. It'd be like Jen filming me. You know what I mean? Like that I've already established in those barriers.
Yeah.
It's gonna go
viral.
Exactly. There's the one I saw on Reddit the other day of a girl who when she was, I think she had them film it because it went up on her Snapchat or whatever, but was when she was going under, they were filming her and she's like, cool, when I come to, just don't let me tell my mom about graduation weekend last weekend. And so when she came to, they were all laughing and they were filming her and they were like, so what happened last week? And she was like, she started and then like the nurse was like doing the talk, like the mom knew obviously, but was like trying to talk her down. And like, eventually she like, incepted the idea that she stayed home and watched Titanic or something. I think it was Titanic.
Yeah.
And then she goes, and it was so sad. And the girl goes, it was so sad. And she started sobbing, remembering Titanic. Just being cold sad was the emotion. It was fucking funny.
The one I'm thinking of was the son that was telling the nurse, show me your tits. I want to see your tits. Yeah, and he kept saying that. And then like the mom and dad are like, okay, that's enough, you know. And then eventually they were like, you should say that. And then he was like, hey nurse, I'm sorry. I didn't mean to be that way. Like he was just super apologetic. But it was just funny whenever somebody has sort of a drunk slur to her, like, oh man, I didn't mean to do that to you, man. Like you sort of just feel worse for him.
Being terrified going under for wisdom teeth because they had essentially told me that one of my teeth that was growing in, it was growing in such a weird way that it was almost on top of a nerve. And so they had told me before my surgery, so there's like, hey, there's like a 50-50 chance that once we're done with this, you may never have feeling in this side of your mouth ever again. It was like, Jesus. Oh, cool.
I would be like this. I want another doctor. I don't like you.
Bedside manners, and I had totally forgotten about it when I woke up because, I was drugged out of my mind.
To me,
I was pretty drugged out for that week.
I see that as a blessing because I would, if I were to ever get mobbed by a criminal who wanted to threaten me and was like, give me your wallet or I'll stab you. Right. You know what I mean? Like mugged.
Okay.
Andy, I'm going to mug you. Give me your wallet. Give me your money. And I would say, please don't stab me in the back of my mouth. It really hurts there. Yeah. And then they would use that as a stabbing point. No feeling, no pain.
Now, remember, of course, you'd still bleed. You're not invulnerable. Mm-hmm. You just don't feel the pain. So you're still bleeding really badly out the back of your mouth, choking on your own blood as you try to call 911.
Gotcha. I mean, I just feel like if I'm not feeling it, like, did it happen? Did a bear shit in the woods, you know, if you didn't see it?
I mean, no, I assure you it happened. Yeah, no, it was a big deal.
Tim's butt dirty if you can't smell it. I'll tell you one thing other too, is that the knife in the back of your face here, very dangerously close to your brain too. So if that's true, it's possible you might lose the ability to like tie your shoes or something important.
A lot
like
of bone there. A lot of bone there, though.
There is a lot of bone there. Not so much in your mouth. Once you go through the mouth, absolutely no bone. just bone kind of here and in your jaw. So if they
can hit you bones too.
I'm just picturing somebody doing brain surgery. Like I could just totally fuck up these person's motor functions, but a lot of bone here.
I don't feel like you real talk as a
stakes
weird,
are low.
I read an article about Elon Musk. God bless the guy.
I've heard of him.
If you say something scientifically crazy that you don't think is going to ever be possible, chances are he owns a company that's trying to do it. And one of the things they're doing right now, and they've been researching for a long time, are these neural implants that they used to be big, but now they're about the size of a quarter and they sit flat, so you don't really even see them. Evidently, they're like, dude, this shit's going to cure everything. But I read a quote with him. So obviously they're doing it to be able to cure like people who have neural issues. I guess I don't know if it was Alzheimer's or things like that. And also,
it's also like early diagnosis and stuff. And apparently, yeah, you can also, if you think of a song, you can hear it in your head, and you can also telepathically talk to other people with implants.
So that's terrifying.
Mass effect.
But one of the things they talked about was potentially putting an implant in the spine as well, and working with paralysis to have that implant like talk to the other implant and like, you know.
Sure.
Basically bypass the central or the nerves, the nerve endings that run usually run those signals. I was like, oh, that's really cool. But then at the end of every article about Elon Musk, if you scroll down enough, and I normally don't read all the way through articles because too long, right, Andy? Like, come on.
Oh, for sure.
To,
yeah.
You know, but
you
I get down to
the headline tells you all the news.
Mm-hmm. Elon Musk curing brain stuff. I got it. But if you scroll down, I urge you always to scroll down to the bottom of any article that has to do with that man, because there's always a moment where you're like, oh, we should stop him. In this specific one, he was like, well, ultimately, my goal is to merge man and machine and usher in the new era of AI and give them basically host bodies or something to that degree. Where he was like,
dude,
this will allow us to have a direct interface with the impending AI and form the singularity. And he goes, at least that's my hope. Like, fingers crossed, I can bring apart the doom and damnation of all human society.
Greg,
but in the interim, It'll
he did the, regulate. He did the green ending in Mass Effect 3 synthesis.
That's what I think I went to as well. Yeah. Who remembers anymore? It doesn't matter.
Terrifying.
Yeah, I don't remember anymore.
Didn't really matter.
I mean, I feel like he, obviously, he's crazy. He says a lot dumb shit. He does a lot of dumb shit. But I feel like he was one of the bigger outspoken sort of people in the science community saying, hey, we really have to worry about AI. We should really not fuck with it, and we cannot be this careless with it. But then he's saying stuff like that. I just feel like, well, you know, what's it? What's the deal? What's going on?
My thought is that AI. Here's my conspiracy theory. You ready for this, Greg?
I'm ready.
My thought is that AI is already here, and they've made a deal with him, and they're like, "Listen, just get everyone to put implants into the brain, and we'll let you live, and it'll be fine." And that's
wow.
It. Yeah,
that could be a Rick and Morty episode.
Probably is. I probably stole it.
Could be a Black Mirror episode. You know what I mean? Could be a bunch of episodes. Yeah. Could be a lot of things. Could be an episode of this show.
Honestly, Nick, you should write like a script like that. That'd be cool.
Of the AI that's already around.
Yeah.
Oh, I'd be doing that.
It would start Tim in his dirty butt.
I was gonna say, there's no way. So here's the thing that I've talked about so far, and guys, I tried to be good. So far today, we've gone down a rabbit hole of socks that one may or may not ejaculate into, and we've just. Cum socks. And then of course, we've talked about Tim's maybe soiled, maybe perfectly clean drawers. So
we're two for two. I hear they are super clean. I hear they are absolutely clean.
Off them.
Well, I hear that if you don't have any bucks to toss our way, it's no big deal. You can get the show for free each and every week on youtube.com/kindoffunny and podcast services around the globe. Of course, you don't get to be part of the show by doing that. You don't get it ad-free, and you don't get the post-show. You don't get to watch it live, just like the Lou and Dale Slapwell is. But it's no big deal. We appreciate the support no matter where you get it. Thank you. Of course, shout out to our Patreon producers for the month of September, Mohammed, Steve Combs, Julian the Gluten-Free Gamer, Blackjack, Lee Polero, Kieran O'Donnell, and Steve Powers. Today we're brought to you by Lumen Skin, AT&T 5G Cross Samsung, and Hims. But I'll tell you more about that later. For now, let's start with a listener-submitted question, just like you can do at patreon.com/kindoffunny. This one comes from a young man we've never heard from before named Ignacio Rojas. Ignacio writes in and says, "What is happening, Kind of Funny crew? IGN recently posted a question on Twitter that I thought could make for a good podcast topic. Rank the bat suits from worst to best.
Yeah.
Anyways, as always, keep fucking that chicken. Here is a link to the post. Barrett, throw it up. If you are one of the many podcast listeners driving your van right now, you're out in the fields working your tractor, maybe you are doing one of those surgeries where you're man, a lot of bone right here. You're in the operating room and you so can't look bone. At this. We will tell you the bat suits after this quick message that Joey Noel went out of her way to fuck me over today and added a Patreon producer after she finalized the list. So wow. She waited for me to put these into the document today to do my
fucking
job. She wants
you to look like an idiot.
And then she wanted to do her job late just to make me look like a fucking moron. So that's also crazy. We have Chaminda Hangopola is also a Patreon producer. And Chaminda, I would very much appreciate you writing in and telling me how to pronounce your first and last name because I don't want to butcher it. And I have a feeling I probably did because I'm a dum-dum.
Joey's
trying to defend herself.
Yeah. Oh, here we go.
I was double-checking something. Let me tell you something Tim the Toolman Taylor taught me, Joey Noel, all right? Measure twice, cut once, all right?
Exactly. Yeah. Exactly, you, Joey.
Here's Joey Noel working in an airport, all right? The plane's ready. The plane takes off and it's gone. And she looks like, oh no, the wheels. I didn't put the wheels on the plane.
How did it take off without the wheels?
How did it take off? How did it take off?
See, what I thought he was going with is, hey, nobody's on the plane. But instead, the plane somehow miraculously managed to take off without its landing gear.
You know where I thought he was going to go? I thought he was going to say, measure, what's the thing?
Measure twice, cut once.
Yeah.
I thought you were going to say measure twice, wipe thrice. Jeez. Like you're wiping your asshole. I thought we were
actually. This is a good thing, Joey. Since you're watching, do you want to defend Tim and his smell? What do you smell around the house? Let us know in the comments below.
We've never said he smelled. I don't know.
Well, that's I think. You know, what I mean, it's just a natural order of conclusion. Anyways, if you are working in an operating room right now, listening to this while you do some spinal surgery, we're gonna rank the bat suits from worst to best. The first thing about this, of course, is how offensive it is that Adam West is not included.
Absolutely.
Absolutely. We will not do. I mean, you can even toss in Kevin Conroy if we really wanted to get nuts, but we won't. This is IGN, of course, as I like to call him, Johnny Cut Corners.
No, this is a terrible list.
Do you want to solve it? I mean, we can fix it. We can add Adam West to this.
No, I mean, the Adam West is fine. It's not the most egregious offense here. What is that for Michael Keaton, they've used the Batman Returns suit, not the 1989 suit, and that's
with the weird
unacceptable.
The weird
this one was the one with the weird angled muscles and. Just was slightly more wet looking.
Okay, so if you're... what do you want to do? How do you want to correct it? What do you want to do? Are we building our own list?
Nick, you're complaining a lot. Not a lot of solutions.
Yeah, you know what I mean? Don't be a Joey Noel about this. Be an Andy Cortez. Fix the thing. Don't
I
make
feel
it
like,
worse.
By the way, I feel like if Tim were on this, he'd be like, shit, this would be a great list to keep while we're doing in review instead of the MVPs. Ass.
Oh, that's a great point, by the way, too, everybody. Don't forget that. I meant to say that in the front. We're doing Batman in review starting next week. We will start with the 1966 Batman movie featuring Adam West, who was screwed over in this IGN list.
I think this is definitely one of the podcasts within a podcast was going to be either the suits or just the Batman or favorite ways that the parents die.
Those are all great things.
Yeah.
Why don't we just tell the ranking too, since they're giving away the whole fucking show next week? You know what I mean?
Number one. Okay. So I will just for the sake.
So here we go.
Here's the thing. For the sake of argument, can we just assume that number one is not that suit? It's the 1989 suit for A.
I don't even know what that looks like.
Barrett, that's the thing is, I think we're going to be way more. As we get ready for Batman in review, we'll be way more informed when we do it. Even if we wanted to do this list then, I think right now it's off your memory. Then it's a different thing.
Okay, I'm just saying, Barrett.
But I also
for context. Can you bring up the 89 suit just so Andy can see it?
I googled it.
Okay, there you go. So the audience can see it as well.
How does it look different?
So if you Google 1989 Batman versus Batman Returns suit, and you'll see a marked difference. The second suit looks a lot like more like armor, like shields. The first one looks like jacked out, ripped muscles, which is what kind of what started the modern day superhero having muscles built into the suit. Look,
Got it.
And then for some reason, I have to assume it was for Warner Brothers and DC to sell more toys. They just decided to fuck it up and change it.
Sure, you got to change it up a bit. Yeah,
I'm not against it. I'm just like, dude, fucking go with it. Go. You should have gone with like a gray suit or something cool like that. They didn't change it quite enough. But I digress. I've ranted enough. We can go.
So you are in an operating room right now. Here's what we're just going to rank what's on the page here from IGN.
Okay, let's just rank on the page.
Then when we do our show, if we want to add stuff again, Batman in Review starts next week, youtube.com/kindoffunny in review podcast services. So here's how it looks then. So A is Michael Keaton. Now, this is specifically as Batman. As Nick points out, Batman Returns, Michael Keaton. B is Batman Forever, Val Kilmer. However, this is the Sonic Batsuit from the end, right?
Yeah, that's not like,
the Batsuit. This line is the bat one.
Yeah, exactly. So that's the one we're rating. That's how it is. Done. Okay. George Clooney, then, Batman and Robin, the bat nipples, lest we forget.
Now, again, no, we've already established this. This is a misnomer. The bat nipples showed up in the Val Kilmer version.
We're coming right off this.
It's true. I'm just letting everyone know because they're going to be like, oh, they're wrong. We're not wrong.
IGN.
Apparently, Josh is wrong. Yeah. We've known that for years. There's a reason we all left. All right. Barrett, high five.
Greg.
Yeah, that's right. Andy, get in there. Remember?
All right.
Yeah, remember what you were at IGN, Andy? Remember?
I hated it, dude. Hated that place. God,
Barrett was so mean to you all the time.
Not enough arcades, I always said.
Yep, that was the big problem you had with it for sure. D is Christian Bale, Batman Begins. Now, E is Christian Bale, and this is Dark Knight.
Yes.
That's Dark Knight. Yeah, it's Dark Knight.
Dark Knight Rises is essentially the same exact costume, too.
Okay. Yeah,
but I think that's specifically a promo image from the Dark Knight.
Yeah, it's got that background behind it, but I wasn't sure if that was something IGN added in post, you know what I mean, to try to do the whole thing where they skew the numbers in the
poll. Can I throw in a worst one right now?
No, off this list?
It's not even on the list. It's the navy blue and silver one that Clooney had in Batman and Robin.
The navy blue and silver one. I don't remember.
It was like really, really dark blue with silver. It was so.
Oh yeah. The one they put on the end when they were the matching outfit.
Right.
Yeah. It's all matching. Yeah.
Now Robin has always had cool suits. I'll say that. I love Robin's version of that.
Lie.
And the movies? Shiny one. Yeah, the shiny one is really cool too. I love that shit as a kid. As a kid, I was like, I really that kid's cool. That guy's cool. Chris O'Donnell. I want to be like him when I grow up.
Wow. Can't believe these are the words coming out of your mouth. Mm-hmm. F is Ben Affleck, Batman v Superman. And then G is Ben Affleck, Batman v Superman, but him in the armored suit, like Dark Knight style, Dark Knight Returns style. Mm-hmm. And then H is Robert Pattinson in the Batman. This is what we will be rating off of. Best to worst. We're using IGN's content to make our own content before we make more content for Batman in Review next week.
Now, if I may, Greg Miller.
Yes. Yeah, of course, as I said it before, Bear Courtney on the ones and twos, Batman, superfan.
Nick, I appreciate you because you have a lot of love for the 89 Batman. But here's my thing. Looking at this suit, this is Returns, as we digress earlier. Mm-hmm. There's something about this suit that just reminds me of this character from Doctor Who, where he just kind of looks like a weird potato. I don't know what it.
Oh, no.
It doesn't. He just. There's something about it.
He doesn't have a defined neck. I understand that. They want that hard silhouette to be like the bat symbol.
Yeah.
But I understand what you're coming from there, and we will take it under advisement.
Okay. And I will say here, Batman Begins, definitely over The Dark Knight.
I would say, for me, this is going to be a hot take. But I think Ben Affleck from Batman v Superman is the coolest of all these costumes that are displayed here. That's my
number. Which one?
F.
Okay.
Remember when we first saw the image of that with him, like it was that grainy black and white image.
Yeah, totally.
Yeah.
Snyder leaked.
It's the one that Kevin Smith was like, I saw this costume and my mind was blown. My jaw was on the ground.
Sure.
That Ben Affleck costume is the first time that I think they've actually captured on screen what in my brain Batman should look like. And talking like quintessential Batman, where he is above six feet. And does have a lot of muscle on him, and you see that he does feel like a hulking giant that could legitimately just throw people around. And if he's incredibly trained, he could just fuck up anyone that he comes across. Of course, not Superman. So that when I first saw that, I was like, oh, man, this actually does look really, really cool. And I'm also just a sucker for that Dark Knight, that Frank Miller style.
Right. Batman. I remember you and I, that was one of the things you and I geeked out about it. It was the first time Batman was like, had a different body shape, really.
Yeah.
Like in terms of like, I am like, squat, I'm fucking beefy, rather than a more lean Batman who's doing more of the martial arts stuff.
Yeah. And you know, obviously when Keaton took the role, the big question was like, how is he going to be menacing in a Batman suit? And I think they did a really good job with it. But there are moments where you go back and watch the 89 Batman, you're like, well, he's pretty fucking short. Granted, the ears are like 8 feet tall in that first one. So that kind of helps out a little bit. Yeah. But it never, he just, to me, that's kind of like when they said they were making a Batman movie back in the day when I was a kid, before they kind of announced who was going to be in it and what that was going to look like. I just imagined, like when I closed my eyes, I imagined something closer to the Ben Affleck suit than what we ended up getting with the 89 Batman. But I think that they did a good job at sort of explaining, hey, this is his armor. This allows him, he gets shot multiple times in that and then bounces back up. And I'm like, oh, that's like, that's awesome that he actually uses the suit for what it's supposed to be for, which is like, you know, combat and to repel bullets and stuff. But yeah, Batfleck for me is moves and feels the most like a Batman that I've ever seen in my life.
The thing I don't love about the list is the fact that it does include the sort of iron armor suit where he fought Superman. Like, I feel like if you're going to include one variant, include all the other variants or just no variants at all. I agree with Nick. I do think that the Batflex suit is number one for me.
Wow. Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
I've always loved that sort of iconic look. And I love the fact that it was gray, where everything else has sort of been black with another black sort of Batman bat logo on the front. I love the fact that it was gray. That sort of, I don't know, the material of it looked really unique as well.
So again, we have eight costumes to rank here, right? And it's supposed to, as we live and die by this IGN thing they built here, of course, IGN.com, your number one stop for all your stuff. They have it here worst to best. So I'd like to get worst on the board.
Okay,
first.
Let's do worst.
Oh, I'm sorry.
I think Batman Forever, Val Kilmer, there is the worst.
We're
going off of what we have.
Yeah, I hate this. I hate this, Greg. I understand, but I hate it.
I understand. I understand that you hate it, but sometimes you got to accept what you hate and eat mac and cheese.
I would go with that with George Clooney's number C, letter C is the worst.
Really? Clooney over.
It's the size of the logo with I don't know, Val Kilmer's is pretty bad too. Val Kilmer's does look, it just screams 90s in the worst
way. It just
way
doesn't
where
look
everything
functional.
Was, everything yeah, was
his
overdone.
His suit doesn't look
too
functional. Right.
And if anything in favor for Clooney, the cowl looks better, I would say.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Agreed. 100%.
Yeah, for sure. You know what? It does feel like on Kilmer's. You know what? Yeah, put Kilmer's as worst because Kilmer's looked like Oakley fucking designed it.
It the whole movie looks like that. Schumacher was very into that over design because he's got the vents on the side and all that stuff. At least Clooney's was a little more straightforward. It was just kind of boring.
So from there, are we just saying then George Clooney, Batman and Robin is number seven, second worst?
I would say so.
It seems like that was the one we were all debating, and I agree with that one.
I would say so.
Although, actually, I'm going to throw you guys for a little curveball here.
I'll say 89.
Really?
You
really
got, the 89 like, suit is dope.
It's dope.
The and now, hold on. Now, you know what? Actually, I guess I am arguing. I'm with Nick on it that I think 89 suit is the great suit. Batman Returns and the weird, like, what do you even call them? Like, panels? The shelves he had for abs rather than, like, human abs? I didn't dig that as much. So I do think this is an inferior suit to 89. I am arguing on the merits of 89. But that said, even. I like the return suit more than other ones on this list.
If you go online to their website and you look at the Clooney suit, it looks a lot.
What website am I going to?
Yeah, their website.
Well, IGN.com, because I think you pulled an Instagram poll, right?
Oh, we pulled their one from Twitter here. This is Ignacio Rojas pulled this. Remember, this is Ignacio. Right. He paid for this. This is what he wants.
So do me a favor, Barrett. If you can go to IGN.com/article/Batman-movie-bat-suit-Rob-Pattinson-Affleck/Bale.
I'm just going down here.
If you just Google IGN Batman suit rankings, we can see the 89 bat suit a little bit better here. And also you can see the other variants for the Clooney suit, the Val Kilmer suit and the Clooney suits, and they're fucking insane. But I'm sorry, you know what? There's a lot more in here than there is.
Right, let's look at it. Let's have some fun. We can look at it. Okay. But I still say we stick to Ignacio wanted this Twitter thing
done. Because
I want our own rankings when we come to Batman in review next week.
I just feel like a lot of y'all came at me really, really aggressively when I said that I liked Robin suits. And I need you to understand that in the mind frame of a 10-year-old Andy or however old I was, Robin has always been super cool because he's the sidekick that is always fucking up, but he's always like, you know, trying to get the ladies and stuff. I don't even know if he was trying to get the ladies in my mind.
Batman Forever, he was. He very much was.
But the idea that the color.
Look at how dumb
color
he looks
variants.
Right here, Andy. Look at how dumb he looks.
Why did they go through and they're like, you know what? Make the cod pieces silver too. Let's really draw the attention.
Dude, no.
Schumacher really liked, he wanted to get that part
I think Robin's color variant here is like miles better than Clooney's, because Clooney's just look like it's something I designed as a kid. Like the lightning bolts on the legs and the tiger stripes in the arms. Like there's so much and going like, on with Clooney's.
Weird like ab non ab thing going on in the
middle
too.
But the thing with the thing I love about Robin's approach to it is that the silver pieces are more of just segments as opposed to just silver for design. Sure, I could say that maybe not the legs are right, but like the fact that the forearms are silver, the shoulders are silver because that's the Robin logo kind of going down the chest, and the belt slash codpiece is also silver, where Clooney's is just like, it looks like something I would have drawn and said like, oh, this is a new Batman leak. Like, you know, back in the day, we would always make our own Dragon Ball Z characters and you would download them pictures on Kazaa thinking that they were actual official images, but they're all just shitty fan art. That's the Clooney here looks like something that I would have drawn as like, oh, this is apparently a new Batman leak, but it just looks really crappy. It looks so bad.
I'll agree with you that the Robin costume here, which I thought was a marked much better than Robin had been portrayed before in the little tiny, you know, underwear and the leggings and stuff like that.
This
to me looks a lot more like a more modern iteration of what Robin would look like. And obviously we've seen those then go into the animated properties and then some of the comic books and stuff. And then of course the Nightwing, that is basically the Nightwing outfit right there.
Yeah.
That's the point. So I do like how he's, I think Robin looks better in these movies than he had looked prior to these movies. But I think he's looked back. I'm still kind of a sucker for.
But even the way he looked before this color variant, I loved like the sort of sheen of the costume. It looks super uncomfortable and not practical. But the sort of green reflection, like not even reflection, it was just sort of like a brushed, kind of shiny material. The green and the red just looked really cool.
From Batman Forever,
yeah.
This list is ridiculous because Val Kilmer's first costume is dope. It's the one with the very first one with the nipples, but it is basically like an enhanced version of the 89 Batman.
Yeah.
Barrett, can you do me a favor, Barrett? Can you pull up the, do you have the, I'll just send you this article. Sorry. Let me just Slack this to you. You can pull this one up because this has a carousel of images in it that I think we should go through just for context.
Dude, Robin's green. He looks crazy. So cool, man.
The Robin, like Batman Forever Robin I'm looking at right now. Yeah, he doesn't look bad. I mean, I don't like this idea of the suits in general. I didn't like the shiny metal part of it thing going on. I want him to be a little more in the shadows. I know it's not Robin's thing even. You know, he's got the yellow for a reason.
Okay, so, yeah, Barrett, if you can...
Sorry, I'm just going to recrap here really quick.
Yeah, no, you're doing great. Thank you so much, Barrett.
Recrappy.
I'm going to recrap. There we go. So that's Val Kilmer at the end of the movie. That's like the Sonic suit that he wears, right, Greg? If I'm not mistaken.
Yeah. You're as blind as a bat.
Exactly. Cool. So Barrett, go over to the right a couple. I just want people to see. Oh, so that's the original Clooney suit.
Oh.
I think that looks way better than the ones that he wears.
No,
at the end.
He looks like a predator in that suit. No,
a little naked. That one's a bit too sexual. That's why everybody equates the nipples to this, because like all that, like he's got it going on there. That's Clooney naked.
Yeah. Go over.
Yeah. Like you're gonna go
like his dick and balls are hanging out in this one.
He's basically just wearing a belt. Go over one more.
This one is actually dope as hell. Man. Hell yeah.
See, that's pretty cool. But sorry, one more, Barrett, and one more. Keep going. One more, and there it is. That's the original
Val Kilmer. Yeah,
that is. To me, that looks cool. I remember seeing that when I was a kid. I was like, this is a dope update of the 89.
That was the thing. Forever gets looped into being
Batman and Robin.
I liked Forever. And I haven't watched it. I mean, I was a kid. I was a kid too. You know what I mean? So like maybe I'm in the same boat as Andy where I liked Robin. I was excited to see Robin on screen, even though I don't like Chris O'Donnell in the part that much. He's a fine person. I actually don't know. Chris, he could be a complete horrible person. But you know what I mean? And I thought the colorful, whimsical Two-Face and Riddler made sense for those interpretations of those characters.
Right.
I'm sure I'll watch it again during Batman review and be like, oh my God.
Okay. To me, though, this picture especially, because this just isn't a good picture to showcase this, because this looks like someone dress up as like on Halloween as Batman. Like it looks.
I think it's also weird. The fact that it looks like it was taken on a disposable camera.
This was like a costume. This was like one of those weird.
All right, Val, get where you need to be. All right, thanks.
Hold on. Let me get
another one here. Do you want to do any other pose? No, you just want to keep awkwardly standing there.
Uncomfortable. He looks like the son that like didn't really want a photo taken, but did want one, and they were like, smile, and he didn't want to smile here, but he kind of wants to smile.
Barrett, go over one more until you hit the 89 Batman suit. And again, that's a dope. No, I mean, classic. That's the return suit, Andy. So wait, go back. Sorry, there we go.
That's another publicity still that looks like a TV's publicity.
That looks like a toy.
Did it? It went so fast, and I have it small screen. Let me throw it up.
Andy, do you see how his chest plate looks a little bit more like futuristic armor in this?
Yeah, I see. Yeah, instead of muscle.
So go over two more, Barrett, so people can see. That's the suit. That's my favorite suit of all.
Is that a toy or is that him?
That's him. Again, these are like costume. These are like from my costume test and stuff like that.
That might be a picture of a toy, honestly.
Yeah, coming this Friday to ABC, Michael Keaton's Batman in over his head.
And again, I'm just going to throw this guy up. It just reminds me a lot of this man.
I see the reminder. I see what you're talking about. I'm not saying you're crazy.
That guy reminds me of a Goomba from the Mario movie.
Fair. Also true. Fair. I can see that too. I can see all these things. I am the all-seeing eye right now.
I love this.
Now, anyway, Let's go.
I just wanted to get my piece out about why I like the Robin suits.
Okay. So right now, worst to best, we have it at number 8, Batman Forever. That's B. And this is, of course, if you're an audio listener, you're driving the ambulance right now, someone's in the back, OD'd. What the B one is. They're back there. Your partner's screaming for help on the phone. Why is he not using a radio? I don't know. He's using a phone. He needs more.
All right.
Number 8 is B, Batman Forever, and this is the Sonic suit from the end of it. Number 7 is C, Batman and Robin, just the traditional George Clooney, too sexy. It's just too sexy.
But also
it's his torso looks super small because of the lighting compared to his head. He looks like his little tiny waist.
He also looks a little bit Andy, kind of like that time that I sent you a bunch of footage of me naked for the that TikTok comparison video that we did.
That's kind of
what he looks like there. I'm gonna say this as a number, what is it, 8, 7,
number six.
I really don't like, and it was a hot take, everyone, so get your fucking pencils out so you can post on the internet or whatever the hell you have to do on your fucking Android devices. I don't like the Batman Begins suit. I think it's too chunky. I think the velvet cape was a huge mistake. And I think I hate those little triangles that hold the cape onto the cowl. I don't like anything about it.
Damn.
At all. I don't like Christian Bale. The ears look like they're too close together. And he just looks doofy in it. And the mouth
hole's
not
big enough. I could merge the Begins and the Dark Knight suits together and take the best aspects of it. Because what I don't love about the Dark Knight suit is the lack of a cowl being super visible. Or not the cape, rather. Right. The lack of the cape kind of, because right now it looks like he's just kind of in a black, like he's in front of a black background and he has no cape. He just kind of looks like he's capeless or whatever. And I wish it sort of took over more of the top part. I wish it looked more integrated with the actual cowl. But I really like them both quite a bit. But I see what you're saying, Nick, where I don't love those little triangles. They look like little collars. It looks like a collar.
It looks like he popped his little vampire collar. And someone was like, we have a little. This, I know exactly what someone was thinking. Someone was like, hey, this would be like a little subtle nod to like Dracula. And then Christopher Nolan's like, I don't really read Batman comic books. So sure. Is he a big Dracula fan? And they're like, we don't really know. And they just threw those on there. And then by Dark Knight, someone was like, can we fucking get people who know Batman into this? Thank you. Make a dope suit.
I mean, dude, I would like
made all that the, up. I don't know.
Here's what I'm going to say. Here's what I'm going to say. A lot of you, so get ready to get fucking pissed off.
Get your pencils ready for your Android devices.
And be prepared. I'm actually in the same apartment as you. I can come get you.
I'm getting. I like D and E better than A.
I'm with you, Andy. So I'm with you.
Right there, he's saying he likes Batman Begins and The Dark Knight better than Batman Returns.
Yeah. And a lot of it is not because of the photo that you showed, Barrett, but just I've always felt that about Keaton Batman. And it just kind of, I guess Keaton Batman was the first one that I ever recognized of like the giant neck that just doesn't really move. And it, I don't know, I never loved it. It feels a little too
stiff.
Yeah, it feels a little too stiff. And I guess the yellow logo just never really did it for me.
So dope.
So, yeah,
well, I will say.
Hold on, no, it's my turn to fucking.
Sorry,
talk.
Fuck.
Get your pencils ready. Get your Android devices ready.
And it pains me to say it with Nick on it, where I think it's Batman Begins the next one. And I think we've crossed that thing where I don't think these suits are bad anymore. Know what I mean? Like, I don't think they're bad, but I think I like the Dark Knight suit better than Batman Begins. And I'm saying this again based on this image. I haven't thought about this in years, but I'm right there with you, Nick, of like, I always thought the ears were too close together. Have that they just cut in more.
Yeah,
on the kind of a weird suit that gives it a weird head shape compared.
Like,
to
Like look at the intensity of the ears on the return suit versus the doofiness of Batman Begins. Like, look how fucking scary as shit he looks from Andy just from the butt chin up.
They look like they're kind of cowering, like,
Andy, you bring up this point of like, oh, you know, that in the 89 returns, Keaton Sudi couldn't turn his head or whatever, and like, blah, blah, blah. Like, I don't think we realized that at the time because that was such a revolutionary Batman to see on screen.
Right.
And it was very much the fighting style they did with it. Whereas, like, now we're looking back and you've seen decades now of different Batman and how fucking.
Well, but that's cool not true because we've only ever seen really one Batman where he can turn his head. Because remember when they went back to Batman v Superman, I don't think Affleck could turn his head either. I think they just made the cowl a little bit smaller, so it wasn't as noticeable. But they made a joke about it. That's how hilarious it was back in the day. Every single actor had complained that they were like, "Dude, it's so hard to do action sequences and to like emote and to be in the character when you have to stay like, you know,
yeah,
you got a neck brace on the entire time." And Keaton famously hated it, and he hated being in the suit. But that's why they made that joke about it. But it took them all the way till Batman Dark Knight to figure that out. And I think it's just so sad too, because the idea of Batman being able to move his head would give him so much more range of motion just to be the character, like to be a little bit more ominous and have the cowl out and do cool shit with the costume. But yeah, when we go back to Batfleck, he goes back to having that, like, he reminds me of like Tito Ortiz when he had the neck surgery and came back and his bones were fused and he just kind of did this and then got fucked up a bunch of times. God damn it. I hate it.
I don't love G either. Like, I it's the whole variant. I know we're playing by the rules, but I would rather have both Nolan's D and E, Batman Begins and Dark Knight, over the Superman killer suit.
Really?
Like I would just prefer, I prefer the look of both of them. I'd rather be Batman in those forms than super heavy, Batman with light up eyes. How does he even see those things? Greg, you ever asked that? Something about that.
How does Iron Man do it? Just fucking pwned you.
How about that?
Just fucking pwned you. You know what I mean? You're jerking off the MCU all the time.
Iron Man doesn't do anything anymore because he's dead.
Damn it, Fox. Spoilers.
Spoilers, bro.
Spoilers for Endgame. He fucking dies, bro.
Sorry if you're in the car with your kid now and you're going to watch fucking Endgame tonight. You fucking terrible dad.
We were saving it. My kid was just born 21 weeks ago.
Oh, they were watching 1 week. I see what they did.
Yeah.
Exactly. So wait, you're trying now in this argument that we have of where we're placing Batman Returns, you're trying to bring in Armored Suit Batman to see if that gets a bump down to 6 before anything else?
It's possible. It's possible, Greg.
The Dark Knight Returns and all that jazz, like the comic book. Where do you come down with Batflex Metal Suit?
I think it's cool. I
don't hate it. I definitely don't hate it.
No, we're having fun here. We don't hate any of these things.
Yeah, I think it was cool. I think it looks a little clunky when he moved around in it. I think he looked a lot cooler in just the base suit, but obviously for the sake of the plot and for the sake of anything that you know about Dark Knight Returns, like, he had to have that for various reasons. But I think it's cool. I mean, I like it personally. I think it's a lot more, it makes more sense when you're going up to fight people that would be armor. So I like that better than the Batman Begins suit. That's for sure, in my opinion. But I don't like it as much as the Dark Knight suit. The Dark Knight suit, I think, was such a cool, especially since, like, look at the difference between D and E. D looks like, okay, I don't have a cape, but my mom has a big old velvet shawl that I'll just
from
make
Michael's
into a cape.
Art to craft. Yeah.
And I'll just kind of wrap it around me. And then, oh my God, my ears were left in the heat of the car too much and they melted toward each other. But that's
when when I think of that velvet cape you're talking about, I think of when he saves Katie Holmes and he's like sitting on that post and it's like wrapped around him and he kind of looks like some kind of grandmother.
he looks like he's about to be wheeled back into the old folks home for the last time.
Here's my thing about Batman Begins is that
lay the thing about Batman Begins on me, please.
The reason that I like it is because it feels like a solid adaptation of like what he had looked like me growing up in like the 90s early 2000s without it feeling too campy and not like anything like too modern. Like, I like the Dark Knight suit, but it just feels too, it feels too techy for me of like what I like to imagine Batman as, of just like what his suit is. So I feel like D has a good classic style without being too like abrasive or too campy, but I do get the feeling about the velvet cape and looking like an old little lady helping out.
The collar definitely does throw me off, like Nick already said. But the thing I love about the Dark Knight E one is that it looks like it's, I understand that it looks a little like it's maybe too much, but it seems very militaristic.
Yeah. And practical, like, for what he's doing.
Very practical, and as if the suit was built for these purposes, because you're going to go, you need to be able to stop a stabbing. You need to be able to, and it feels, it looks like that's something that would be issued out to people that are going to be, like, you know, in intense combat situations. Well, that's why I've always liked that Dark Knight suit.
Remember, Andy, that the stabbing is the one unfortunate drawback of the Dark Knight suit. Apparently, it can take a bullet, but it can't take a...
The thin blade. That's right. That's right.
Thin blade through the things, because apparently the Kevlar can't take blade.
It's in between the plates. Separation of the plates were weaker to knives. But really quick, I just want to shout out Joe Mertens in the chat, who asks, why do we revere Nolan's D? Andy?
Why do we revere the D, Andy?
Great episode. Man, Greg, if there's ever any doubt that we absolutely need you and we'd be lost without you, just go back and watch any Kind of Funny podcast. just watch about 40 minutes of it, and you'll see what I imagine when you have a kid and you put him on the bike for the first time without the training wheels, and he goes that first 5 feet.
You guys did great.
So proud of my kid, and then the wobble starts. Boom. Right, Greg? The wobble starts, down. And you're like, this kid's
down.
To-
then it's a broken Shit. It's a broken limb, and we're off to the ER.
We're off to the ER.
So wait, then are we?
He's gonna get some Vicodin.
It sounds like. And I'm not trying to just push my own agenda here, but it sounds like we're putting it 6D Batman Begins.
I think so.
The vampire collar, all that stuff.
Yeah. My thing also with that costume is the Begins costume. And again, no disrespect. I like how it sort of has a makeshift homemade feeling to it, but it always just sort of like felt a little saggy on him. Some of the rubber was a little not fitted properly. And I think by the time they got to Dark Knight, the Dark Knight suit just looks like something you could actually fight in. Like, it looks like something you'd be like, okay, my mobility is maybe lessened by 20 or 30%, but I'm more than making up for it in the fact that if someone hits me in the stomach, I can take that really easy. Whereas the other one just looks like he's walking around in something that is sort of like a Stay Puft marshmallow suit, sprayed black.
Who doesn't love that? So then we're at number 5 now, and it seems like from the argument we were having around all this, it's now between Batman Returns A and Batman v Superman Armor G. Would we all agree with that?
Yeah, I would say that.
So out of those suits, which one do you vote for as the worst? We're saying the
worst. I would say A. I think the return suit is just not. I don't know. I would say A.
Wow! I'm surprised.
A little, like, again, it's a little. I know we got to respect the classics. I know we got to respect our roots, but it just doesn't look appealing to me. And also, one other thing about it is, it makes Michael Keaton look weak because his shoulders aren't wide enough. His like, it just looks like he's a kid in a Batman suit.
Yeah, right? He looks like he's a preteen who like hasn't gotten that like growth spurt with the shoulders.
That was totally hear you that you got to respect your classics. I think that was also again designed that way. I think they wanted that. What I when they were talking about doing the Batman or the next Batman film or whatever, I wanted them to go in a different direction. I wanted that, what I've said before, that flashlight, like pen light in his teeth, him going through files in like a more fabric-y, totally low pro. I know, but like, you know, like a more like detective-y thing where it's like, this is, I know, I totally hear you, but I think that was by design, even though it doesn't hold up maybe to the standard. But,
yeah, I just would have preferred like the straight down with the really broad strong shoulders. Yeah.
Some Darwin Cook stuff happening there. All right, then. So then Batman Returns there. And then does that make at number 4 then G, the armored suit from Batman?
Correct.
Okay.
I would say that.
Correct.
Andy, I just sent you the 89 suit lit in the movie so you can see what that really looks like.
Why send it to Andy? Send it to Bear. Yeah, we can all see
it. Yeah, that image definitely looks better than what's being shown here.
I don't know if you know this, Nick. There's me in the room, there's Baird in the room, and a few thousand people.
Well, I just...
But I'll tell you why this image also looks
more listening, having no idea what the fuck we're talking about.
This image also looks better than the one being displayed because it's taken from a bottom-up perspective.
Yeah.
And his head looks smaller.
Yeah.
His head looks smaller also.
He looks more, So this was to me, one of the things I really look at. Obviously, you got when the suits are lit right, they're all going to look a lot better, with the exception of the Schumacher suits because they're just wet with reflectivity. But I liked the matted nature of the 89 suit, and I liked, as opposed to, velvet Batman Begins suit, I thought the choice they made here, making the cowl and the cape look like a harder, almost like roughed up rubber, I just thought that was so cool. It made it look so tough. And I think it was nice because it had a nice little bit of a contrast and pops to the light, whereas the armor underneath didn't. Man, that's cool as shit. Look at that grappling hook, Greg. That shit revolutionized Batman
Are you
there.
Kidding me? Yeah.
Show me another Batman property after 89 where he doesn't have a fucking grappling hook, and I'll show you the door. God damn.
Damn, he would do it, Andy. Don't look for the door because he'll show it to you. And I don't want you to get that.
Show it to me. I don't want to look at it.
So right now, then, worst to best rankings are this for this IGN article, stealing, make our own content. Number 8 is B, Batman Forever. Again, the Sonic suit, if you're watching at home or listening at home while you drive around in your house in your front yard. 7
you got somebody in the back.
Exactly. You're on the riding lawnmower right now, trying to get a few more cuts before fall hits you. I understand. Number 7 is C, Batman and Robin, the Clooney suit there. Number 6 is D, Batman Begins. Number 5 is A, Batman Returns. Number 4 is G, Batman v Superman's armor suit, meaning we have 3 left. They're all in the bottom row there. We have E, The Dark Knight, F, Batman v Superman, Batfleck plane, and then H, Pattinson, and The Batman. So we have to rank these again, worst to best, right after a word from our sponsor. This episode of the Kinda Funny Podcast is brought to you by Lumen. You know who's lazy about their skincare? It's Tim Gettys, but Lumen has changed it all for him. Here's the cold hard truth, ladies and gentlemen. Your skin needs you. If you want it to look as good as possible for as long as possible, you need to address the needs now. We get it. You might not know where to start, but there's a company that's taken all the guesswork out of it for you. It's called Lumen. Lumen is on a mission to help give men the amazing skin they deserve through high-quality, expert-created products delivered right to your door. All of their products are formulated and specifically for men's skin and made to target skin issues with maximum efficiency using top-notch ingredients like charcoal, green tea extract, and vitamin C. It's not just about looking good. It's about feeling good. You need good skin health, especially as you get older, to prevent long-term damage. You all know it. Tim was formerly Forbes 30 under 30. Now he's over 30. He needs it to take care of his skin. Gia had been saying it for a long time. So when Lumen showed up, he started using it and said he is seeing a marked improvement. Even if you have no idea where to begin, Lumen makes it so easy to find the right skin management system for you. You choose from different skin concerns to address or just pick up a free, simple starter pack for free. You deserve to look and feel your best, and here's where to start. Go to lumenskin.com/kindoffunny to get a 1-month free trial of everything you need to start your skincare journey at home. That's lumenskin.com/kindoffunny to get your first month free. Lumen, lumenskin.com/kindoffunny. Our next sponsor, well, it's AT&T 5G plus Samsung. Rooster Teeth is joining forces with Samsung and AT&T 5G to kick off things for their upcoming RTX at home virtual event. Hey, we have panels during that. Rooster Teeth is creating a Ruby outdoor mural that can add art from all sorts of different things and mark this augmented reality app that you get to go do. So download the Mark app and start creating your own Ruby art starting on September 5th through September 7th. Each night, fans' designs will be projected on the mural wall and you could see yours come to life on social. If you're on the AT&T 5G network at home, you can access Plus Mode through the Mark app, so you'll get the highest res video and crystal clear images to explore on the app. Check out the new Samsung Galaxy Note 20 Ultra 5G powered by AT&T 5G. AT&T 5G requires compatible plan and coverage in all areas. Here are just some of the new features you can try out on this device. Cloud gaming will be available, and this is very important to Greg Miller. With the power of 5G, try out cloud gaming with high-performance experiences brought to you via the newest Samsung devices powered by AT&T 5G. The Galaxy Note 20 Ultra 5G also has 120 Hz adaptive display that automatically adjusts the refresh rate according to the content you are viewing, an intelligent battery that optimizes for your gameplay. Head over to AT&T.com/Galaxy Note 20 Ultra 5G to learn how you can get the Samsung Galaxy Note 20 5G for free or the Galaxy Note 20 5G Ultra for $299.99 for a limited time. Again, ladies and gentlemen, AT&T.com/Galaxy Note 20 Ultra 5G. And our final sponsor of the day, ladies and gentlemen, it is Hims. Ladies and gentlemen, you know about Hims. Hims has helped us for a long time. Of course, forhims.com. What's the promo code we're using today? Because they've been here for so long, right? You go to forhims.com/kindoffunny for your free visit. But again, forhims.com/kindoffunny. You've heard us talk about it forever because they've worked with us forever. We've talked about it in the main way of, hey, Nick and Andy noticed their hair was thinning. Hey, they went to forhims.com/kindoffunny. They talked to a doctor discreetly online on their own schedule. That doctor said, you know what? You guys do have a problem. Let us help. And they prescribed generic well-known equivalents to the name brand prescriptions. Saved a bunch of money, saved a bunch of time. And guess what? They started taking the gummies. Their hair is in a great spot. Everybody's super happy. What we're talking about today, though, is ED, erectile dysfunction. Of course, Four Hymns does a whole bunch of stuff. This time, though, we're talking about erectile dysfunction, something you shouldn't be ashamed of. If you have it, it's no big deal. Lots of guys do. And that's one of the reasons Four Hymns exists. Of course, the founder decided a long time ago there are some men's health conversations that are better to be held online than having to book an appointment online or book an appointment on the phone through somebody, then show up, wait in a waiting room, then go in and talk to a doctor. People, first off, don't have enough time for that, and they're embarrassed of that. And you shouldn't be embarrassed of your problems. But 4hymns.com cuts all that out, of course. You go online, you book the appointment around your thing, you talk to a doctor online. You don't have to worry about waiting rooms. You have to worry about seeing different people. You can just do it all from the comfort of your home and see if there are solutions to your problems. So ladies and gentlemen, that's what's happening right now. We're asking you, if you want to, try Hims today, starting out with a free online visit. Go to 4hymns.com/kindoffunny for your free visit. That's 4hymns.com/kindoffunny, forhims.com/kindoffunny. Prescription products are subject to medical provider approval and require an online consultation with a medical provider who will determine if a prescription is appropriate. See the website for full details and safety information. Remember, 4hymns.com/kindoffunny.
Andy, we've decided that the three of us are going to sandbag this ranking and make sure the 89 Batman is there. And if we do, everyone gets bonuses.
Now, this is a great point. We are back on the podcast, by the way. Breaks over. This is a good point that it is just us and Kevin and Tim aren't here. So yeah, we could try to pull one of these like survivors, let's make an alliance kind of thing.
That's what I'm saying.
So we get our way and we do run ruckshot over there when Tim and Kevin are there. Like, I'm not necessarily for it, but I imagine at some point I'm going to need backup on some dumb point I'm making, Andy.
Okay.
I'll back you up on Batman v Superman being number two.
But that's a lie. Like, I don't believe that. I mean, he's not in this. Yeah, DCEU is excluded from Batman.
Oh, we're talking about the movies. I think you meant the costumes.
We can go back to the costumes now. What's up? We're going to finish it. All right, let's finish it off here. So again, thanks for sticking through the break, listener, YouTube person. Remember, if you don't want those ads, you can go to patreon.com/kindoffunny. I'm so used to saying patreon.com/kindoffunny games. I screw it up all the time. Kind of funny. All right, so it's down to
the final three.
Bales, Dark Knight, Batfleck from Batman v Superman, mm-hmm. and then Pattinson, the Batman. And I feel like Pattinson's freshness works for and against him. Because mm-hmm. I think his suit looks fucking awesome.
Yeah.
I think his cowl looks fucking awesome. When they, during the trailer, which of course I hope you've seen, I hope you've seen a reaction. Like, I legit do like the, when Gordon's like, does this mean anything to you? And they pan over to him and he's got his fucking eyes. You can see his, I'm like, holy shit, does that look awesome?
That's cool.
And so, but like, we've seen so little of it that it's that thing of like, how high do we want to take this thing up?
My only drawback with the new suit mm-hmm. is the boots. They look like boots. Just some boots he bought at Mervyn's.
I love that. That's what I love about it, because this is supposed to be Batman year two.
It just doesn't really match the top part though, because the rest of it, while still very practical, the rest of it does look like, you know, essentially like armor pads that you would buy, like almost like football pads, like paddings on the shoulders and all that stuff. That's the only thing that works against me is the boots. But right now, I don't see the boots. And, right? They're not even there. They're not even there in the shot. And so the next worst one would be E for me.
Really?
Yeah. I would put The Dark Knight next, and then Pattinson, and then Batfleck.
Batfleck is so odd. That especially that picture is just not a flattering picture to me.
That's another publicity still, right?
But yeah. I just remember the picture in my head. Like, I remember Robert Pattinson walking through.
Here's what I'll say, Andy, is that for sure with number three, I agree with you, of Dark Knight goes there. And again, I think it's a great suit. I think it works in the film, but it's not an iconic suit to me. When I think of Batman and Batman suits, I don't think of that suit.
Yeah, I agree. So I feel saying, like it's sort of status quo, but it totally works.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So you're saying the Dark Knight
is now number three, is what I'm saying. Leaving then, one and two between Pattinson and Batfleck.
Yeah, so the one thing I'll say about the Pattinson over Dark Knight, and I know we've already ranked it because I guess you guys didn't.
No, we haven't already ranked. Well, I guess, yeah, we voted.
You voted. It's fine. I got outvoted. I'm used to it on this fucking channel.
I'm so mad. I'm popular for being a weirdo, but I hate it.
I'm never cleaning my butthole again.
Joe Einstein. Yeah,
there it is. Fuck you, Joel Schumacher. I like the Pattinson suit for one reason here. And I like it because it looks like he can turn his head in it.
Sure.
I don't love that I got to be honest, I don't love that their solution to that was giving him a collar. But I do love that that collar looks like it would protect against chokes, which is smart. It's smart to have that. Sort of like
knives. Medieval,
collar they would wear for swords and shit. So I like how Pattinson looks in that. And I think I would, just because I like the bigger opening in the mouth, too. I just feel like one of the things about Bales that I always off-putting is that look at the difference between the size of the opening of his mouth from DDE. It got smaller by a variant of about 15%. And I don't know why. I don't know why they wouldn't just open that up a little bit. You know?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I hear you.
Yeah, the opening on Ease is way... Man, the openings on D&E are really bothering me now.
They're bothering
a lot. And they're a lot, small. Dude.
It's really just the shape of D is really weird.
It's the shape. Yeah. It's the shape and just the overall... I mean, I think it's because when I look at the old school ones, the Clooneys, the Kilmers, the Keatons, they are more wide than they are vertical. But these are way more vertical than they are wide. Yeah, like they are more long than they are wide. And I'm just not a fan of that. I love the opening for Batfleck. Pattinson, rather. Pattinson's suit really reminds me of an awesome concept art that you see that just some artist drew on Twitter and you're like, that would be fucking awesome, and it's real.
It's so crazy to me. Yeah.
I think that's why that resonates more with me, and I think you nailed it, is that that looks like if you were trying to be Batman in real life and you drew, like you cobbled together the suit, it looks functional, it looks wicked, and I love that it looks like, I love that they have the spikiness. I mean, it just looks intense. Whereas you go back over to E and it looks like he's wearing a full black suit, but ate one of those white puff, like powdered donuts. And it just kind of got on the part of his mouth. That's circular. It just looks very weird. Whereas I think Affleck's cowl is just almost perfect. It's so, it just fits the jawline perfectly. It accentuates it sharp. It builds Andy as far as like the symmetry of a face, it builds perfectly into the angle of the ears. I just think that looks so.
And he's bulky as hell.
And he just looks like he's just finished all the steroids.
Yeah.
There are no more left in Gotham City. I use them all.
And so I got it. Yeah. So I think Pattinson goes number two.
I'm just going to look up Pattinson's suit again because I just want to look at it, man. It is so cool. Goddamn good looking.
And I also send me the best image you can find, because I did a Google and all I found was the stunt images, and I'm not liking it. I'm hosting a show here.
Yeah.
All right. Number three is the Dark Knight.
Yeah.
Okay. And then between one and two, Nick, you're going Batfleck.
I'm going to go Batfleck number one.
Okay. And then Andy, are you in the same boat?
I'm going Batfleck number one, yes.
Wow.
I think it's dope. I think it's cool.
It just looks so awkward to me. And I can't really describe why.
I think it's because he just looks more buff than normal than all the other Batman do.
I think it's the colorization. The arms are so big. It's the gray torso and legs that feels like off to me.
Yeah, it's missing the bottoms, the little undies, the chonies.
Yeah.
I miss the chonies.
And I mean, think about
the first time you see that suit in that movie, where he's like awkwardly like in that like kind of corner hiding.
He's up on the roof.
Like again, there's no color like highlighting his junk, but I feel like because there's a lack of color there, there's just something that's pointing you towards that area, and it just looks and feels awkward.
My problem with
I do like the logo though. The logo is really cool.
The logo is fantastic. And I think if it weren't all gray, it would look like he was wearing Batman jeans or something like that.
Yeah.
So like if it was gray on top and then the belt and then like black on the legs, it would look like he was just wearing pants and it would look really weird.
Well, remember there was that big debate for the Superman costume when they brought out Man of Steel and they ditched the underwear for the first time. And everyone was like, this is interesting. It has a totally different look to it. I personally like it. I don't think that we need the underwear over the tights debate ever again. But I just thought it was so for Snyder to be like, hey, everyone's done a black Batman suit up to here.
Yeah, we've seen
some variants of it. But man, having him do like gray on black, because to me it looks like urban camo. It's like, oh, you're up in the sky. It is the colors of the sky. It is the colors of like buildings and things like that at night. So I just thought it was
also the material of it. The tough kind of texture.
Yeah, it looks like it's almost like like really poorly done spun carbon or Kevlar.
Yeah.
You know, almost like a whatchamacallit, a fiberglass-ish kind of look to it. I think it's super cool. I think it just that worked across the board. And it was, you know, those parts, especially in like Justice League, when you see him in Gotham, I'm like, it's a cool aesthetic. I know a lot of people didn't like those first few scenes, but I just want to see him. I want to see one standalone Ben Affleck Batman movie, and I know we'll never get it, but
yeah,
man, that would just be so fucking cool and fun.
All right, then the votes have it. I think I'm dealing with the recency factor where I think I love Pattinson's suit, and I think I want to see so much more of it that I think I'm starving for it, and that's why I'm so high on it. It's a great looking suit to begin with. But I think I would have to knock it.
The idea of the pistols in the chest, you know?
Yeah, I know. It's kind of corny.
Like that's. I mean, no, I love that. I think it's cool.
I liked it better in the comics, or the one comic they did where he melted it down and made it into like the emblem, and like just a, like the Michael Keaton emblem, and put it on. Mm-hmm. Like, whereas this is just like actually like he's. I mean, granted, he's moving fast, but the cops are looking at him like, is that just a gun in your chest?
Yeah, I did it so nobody else would get hurt.
That's weird.
It's the gun that killed my parents back in that alley in 76.
Yeah, I know. Bruce I feel like somebody would be able to put it together.
Wait, God, that's interesting.
He just looks badass, dude.
I'll tell you what, badass. I'm very excited for the production design of the Batman. I think, you know, we saw some of the stills of some of the vehicles, but man, seeing the Batmobile in that one shot where the jet engine on the back lights up and it looks like a even more wicked version of Mad Max's car from Road Warrior. I'm like, dude, I'm in. And he's in that warehouse. That's like the Bat Cave, but it's in like the literally out in the middle of freaking nowhere in a cave. Like, I just think it's going to be really fun.
So, ladies and gentlemen,
very excited.
Your final ranking here of this IGN list, according to Kinda Funny, worst to best goes number 8, B, Batman Forever's Sonic suit. Number 7, C, Batman and Robin's Clooney suit. Number 6, D, Batman Begins. Number 5, A, Batman Returns. Number 4, G, Batman v Superman's armor suit. Number 3, E, the Dark Knight suit. Number 2, H, the Batman. And number 1, the best bat suit, Batfleck, from Batman v Superman. Superman!
Ladies and gentlemen. Super suits next.
I'd love to do that. That's your Kinda Funny podcast, unless, of course, you go to patreon.com/kindoffunny, where you can kick us a few bucks and get the exclusive post-show, along with the show ad-free, along with getting to watch it live if you want to, just like Chance Carter is right now.
Chance the Pants.
Chance the Pants. That's what they call them. Remember, if you don't want to hustle any bucks or can't, it's totally cool. You can go to youtube.com/kindoffunny, podcast services around the globe, each and every week to get a brand spanking new episode of us fucking around with each other. Right, Andy?
Nah.
Until next time. It's been our pleasure to serve you.